very glad to welcome Elisabetta Ayerbe from Cidetec Energy Storage. Thank you very much, Elisabetta, for having accepted the invitation to speak today. So with Elisabetta, we are having a very nice collaboration in the topic of manufacturing modeling, and she's leading a European project called De Facto, with a similar scope of the artistic projects. So I think she's going to share with us very nice things, you know, around the topic of manufacturing modeling and so on today. So please go ahead and share your screen. You should unmute your microphone. I think, Mark? You heard Elisabetta? No, I think no.
Can you hear me?
Elisabetta.
Yes, now yes.
Ah, okay, sorry. Okay, so I guess now you can see the slides and...
To see the full screen, you should as first enable the full screen, and after share the exactly perfect.
Now it's
perfect.
Okay.
Perfect.
Oh, okay. So first of all, thank you, Professor Alejandro Franco, for inviting me for being part of this webinar series, first Battery Manufacturing Days. So it's a pleasure to be here. I will be presenting on introducing the De Facto project, and also I will give an overview of what we are doing at Cidetec in the modeling side. So as I said, it's really a pleasure to be here, and I hope you enjoy the talk. So the outlook of my presentation is the following one. First, I will start introducing the De Facto project, which is a European project funded in the topic LCBAT6. And I will give a short introduction to the project. And then I will switch to our explaining our progress on the modeling techniques for cell design, mainly concentrated on numerical algorithms. So as I said, I will start with the De Facto project, and then I will switch to the De Facto presentation. Here we are 13 partners all around Europe. Cidetec Energy Storage coordinating the LCBAT6 funded project called De Facto. And we, together with the rest of the partners, in this way, with the aim on gain understanding on cell manufacturing and cell design through modeling side. So here, CEA is involved, FERT, DLR, Fraunhofer, SCI Group, UNE, Leclanchet, Irizar E-Mobility, EU Braunschweig, UPM Polytechnica, ABE, and Sustainable Innovation. So the duration of the project is 42 months, and it was started last January, and it will continue until middle of 2023. And the total funding was around 6 million euros. So the factual approach is that we are combining modeling together with characterization and prototyping. And the core activity are relating to modeling side. And here we are proposing multi-scale multiphysics to deal and to reproduce in a virtual way the most relevant steps in manufacturing cells. So we will deal with the slurry preparation, coating, and even calendaring steps. Even we will be dealing with electrolyte filling process, and then we will deal with cell performance and even cell aging understanding through, as I said, through multi-scale and multi-physics approach. So all these, for all this, obviously we need to have a characterization, and this characterization will be done to the cells that will be manufactured within the project. And these cells will be an industrial level and even prototype level cells. For the characterization, we need parameters to fit into the models. We need the data of validating models. And again, we need the data coupling with the models to gain understanding on the mechanisms, limiting mechanisms. So the chemistry that will be analyzed through the de facto, the NMC 622 graphite, which are industrial scale cells. And then we will do even the analysis to another chemistry, advanced chemistry, which is NMC 811 graphite silicons, and we will provide some guidelines on the new chemistry LMNO graphite silicon. So if we go, so I didn't say, but the main objective of the project is to improve the understanding of cell behavior and cell manufacturing by means of multi-scale, multi-physics modeling tools. So if we are concentrating on electron manufacturing, Theo and Professor Alejandro explained perfectly yesterday and during the talk of Theo's today was perfectly described the mixing procedure. And so here in de facto, we will be combining DEM approach together with CFD in order to analyze and understand each of the steps, like the one listed here, mixing, coating, and even the drying procedure, and then calendaring. So the idea is to gain understanding on the manufacturing parameters in order to improve these parameters with the purpose on improved performance. Then we will move to electrolyte filling step. Here we are combining mesoscale together with continuous scale approach. So the idea again is to completely understand the electrolyte filling the intrusion procedure in a pore, even at electrode level and even at cell, how the wetting of the electrode is homogenized on the cell and how later will impact on the degradation mechanism. And yeah, as I said, we will be combining mesoscale and continuous scale tools. And then after the cell are assembled, formation step is held, we will be characterizing at different conditions in order to investigate and to address the aging. And more in details, we study the heterogeneous aging of the cell. So here, again, we are proposing a multi-scale approach, starting from atomistic scale, in which the idea is to properly address the mechanical impact on material level, and then to jump up to electrode level, in which at material DFT will be applied, and then to electrode level, we will be focusing in two approaches, DEM and even the 3D resolve based on a commercial tool called BEST. And then from this electrode, what we the once the swelling and the expansion of the electrodes are properly understood, we will upscale to cell level, in which again we have a mesoscale BEST, in which we are aiming to implement this mechanical degradation and even electrochemical degradation so that we can predict the lifetime and even to try to guess improvement on minimizing this degradation. So in parallel, within the de facto, we will develop an open source, basically based on P4D, and it will be a replica of the BEST in a way that, in principle, it will contain electrochemical degradations and mechanical degradations, but it will be an open source as an output of the project. So we expect that the computational cost of this tool will be high, too high, maybe too expensive. So we thought that it would be really interesting to somehow find a way to reduce this computational cost. So we are implementing reduce order methods in here, to basically maintaining the accuracy of the simulation. We are aiming to have an improvement on cost computational efficiency. So once we have this reduced P4D, the idea is to implement sensitivity analysis, even local and global area, so that we can analyze the model robustness And then even we will implement optimization tools so that we can provide guidelines to cell designers in a way that we can provide the electro properties or cell design properties or whatever, minimizing a certain limitation. In parallel, we aim to develop a parametric ROM cell model, basically and mostly oriented to control and fast prototyping. So, and as I said, finally, we have a characterization and even prototyping, which are, of course, very important here because we basically need the data. And here it comes to data from the manufacturing and from characterizing it. So we will do advanced characterization at material level, electron level, and cell level. And then we, as I said in the previous first slide, we will be manufacturing industrial scale, large cells, and even prototype cells. All in all, we'll have, as I said in advance, more understanding on manufacturing and even cell performance and design. And even we aim to contribute to new standardization, basically providing guidelines on shortening the experimental work and even shortening the validation of the model. So that was all from the de facto side. Then I would like to move to the second part of my presentation, which is I have titled the modeling techniques for cell design. And then I will start from non-dimensional analysis. Then I will move to some work we have done recently with the neural network approach. And then I will finalize with the advanced reduced order models. Okay, as Alejandro Franco explained yesterday, I'm not going to go in details to how the electrodes are manufactured. In our facility, Cytotec Energy Storage, we usually manufactured pouch cells, and we have our own facility for manufacturing electrodes. Basically, the electrodes are manufactured by casting a slurry onto a metallic current collector. And what, as I said, I'm not going to explain the details, the procedure, but what we call is that we have some design parameters, electrode design parameters, and the another parameters are related to the manufacturing. So for design parameters, we define the, for instance, the electrode formulation, loading, porosity, tortuosity, and this kind of parameters. And for manufacturing, we can define like the drying profile, coating speed, gap, mixing speed, and time, and so on. So we have these parameters. Then from the electrodes, we assembled cells in our facility. As I said, we are developing large, even large pouch cells up to 40 ampere hours. And again, we have some parameters which are related to the design of the cell. So for instance, geometry, cell capacity, cell dimensions, tap location, and so on. And then we would have the manufacturing parameters like the stacking speed, laminating temperature, electrolyte dosing procedure, and so on. And then once we have the cell assembly, we perform the formation step to stabilize the cell, and then we perform electrochemical characterization just to analyze the cell performance or even the cell age. So you already know all these slides. And here I will talk about the correlation between design parameters and cell performance in a forward design. So for instance, we would have certain parameters in the electro architecture, and then we need to know which is the expected cell performance. And on the other way, it's we have a target in cell performance, and we will need to know which are the best design parameters. This is a backward design. So here I will be concentrated in this field, correlating the design parameters together with cell performance. And as you might know, there are different approaches, and in the continuous scale, which is the framework in we usually work here at CDTech. We have different approaches, starting from the very well-known P2D, single particle with electrolyte, 1D, P4D, 3D, or even P2D coupled to the 2D. Anyway, I'm not going to deal with any of them. I'm pretty sure that today and the rest of the days, accurate models will be described. I'm here just to talk about how to improve the computational cost of the models for the cell design purposes. So our aim, as I said, is that we will provide guidelines how to improve this computational cost, because it's a critical issue here if we need to run several or hundreds or thousand millions of simulations. And I'll be concentrated in the framework of P2D, single particle, and 1D. Anyway, this can be taken as a baseline and can be extrapolated to any model in which you might have partial differential equations or system with these partially differential equations. So yeah, and these are our aim today. I will briefly describe what we've been doing through implementing non-dimensional approach, and then some results in implementation of neural networks hooked to the model, and then the progress on the reduced order models and how we are improving the computational efficiency in this field. So the first one would be related to the forward design. So we have having certain parameters, and we need to know if we will have a limitation. So we would know if we are reaching the expected target. And in the second and third case, we would be more focusing on, or it will be more oriented to backward design. So for the first approach, this is the non-dimensional approach, and here what we call is that we have this quick screening tool, because in the end, if it's a short script in MATLAB in which you can compute these non-dimensional parameters, and then through analyzing these parameters you can identify the limiting phenomena. So the methodology is the following one, is the one listed here. So as I said, I'd be concentrated on the P2D approach. So we have the P2D model. It's a Newman type P2D, you already know. It's a very well-known model. And what we derive is a dimensional version of this model. And one, we have this dimensional, that non-dimensional version of the model. We make it together, all the parameters, and we build the non-dimensional parameters. So for instance, this is the case for a half-coin cell. We have the lithium electrolyte with a separator and the cathode phase, and we have the physicochemical equation, which are mass balance and charge equations for the liquid and the solid phase. And then from here, we build the non-dimensional parameters. So as I said, prior to this, we build the non-dimensional version of the equations, and grouping together, we define these parameters. So basically, we will have the delta sigma related to the electronic conductions. The delta K and delta KD are related to the ionic transport, meaning that we will expect a migration limitation or diffusional limitation. Then we have this concentration gradient dealing with mass transport in the electrolyte phase, and it will be providing the information of the concentration gradient and the separator and the cathode. And then we have the time characteristics related to the how fast the lithium is diffuses along the electrolyte and the separator, and this is related to the flux in the active material particle. And the two final parameters are related to the kinetics. The first one is related to the intercalation kinetic, and the last one is related to the lithium stripping plating kinetic. So as I said, once we have the non-dimensional parameters, we need to do the parameterization. So we need to estimate the parameters for each of the cases that we would need to analyze, and we compute the non-dimensional parameters. So from here, and analyzing the data from the, these parameters, we are identifying the limiting phenomena in the cell performance. So as a proof of concept, I will explain two cases. The first one is validated against experimental data, and the second one was validated against simulation data. So the first case is the solid electrolyte cell design. In this case, we developed a PEO LiFTCI polymer. So, and we assembled the cell with lithium PEO and LFP. And this was, I mean, the PEO was all around the cathode as well. So we assembled the cell and we performed some electrochemical characterization like rate capability. And as you see, this is experimental data. As you see here, there is a huge polarization, even at 0.8C. So here, what we needed to know is that why we obtained this polarization, and there's a limiting phenomena, and this is how we are addressing through the non-dimensional parameters. So yeah, the idea here is to address this limitation, try to avoid the limitation, and then put in place by experimental method. So we did the parameterization. We identified the transport properties of the polymer, solid diffusion coefficients, and cell design parameters as well. And then once we had this information, we compute the non-dimensional parameters for the case of the 0.C discharge C rate. And here what we are seeing is that the delta sigma is too low, meaning that we are not expecting any electronic potential limitations. However, we have delta K and delta KD, it's large, so we would expect ionic transport limitation in here, and this concentration gradient, it's high enough, so according to this number, we would expect lithium electrolyte depletion along the cathode side, as this is discharge, and then these characteristic numbers are saying that we wouldn't expect a great limitation in here. And even with this number is related to the flux. So in principle, high limitation is expected. And due to the regarding kinetics, maybe certain limitation due to the lithium stripping and plating procedure. So basically, the major limitations, we need to also think that the non-dimensional analysis is dealing with order of magnitude. So, but in any way, the main limitations come from ionic transport limitation and electrolyte depletion. So taking this into account, what we decided in order to avoid this limitation, it was to increase the salt concentration here. So we, as in the first case, with the PEO built in the previous slide, the salt concentration was around 800. So we prepared, or we thought that increasing the salt concentration, we could not minimize the gradient, but at least put it in a higher value so that the concentration wouldn't be zero at all in any time. So we jumped from 800 to 200. And that in this case, what we are seeing is that there is a slight reduction in the concentration gradient here. And so taking this into account, we would expect a lower lithium depletion in the electrolyte. And once we built the new configuration with the new salt concentration, so we had, in that case, from the 800, this is related to the 22% of LFTSCI in weight. And then we move to 30%. So we are seeing that we substantially improve the performance. So what we can say is that the non-dimensional approach can anticipate certain or at least main limiting phenomena. Then, as I said, another proof of concern on the validity of this non-dimensional approach is that we have them by comparing to the simulation results. So in this case, we aim to manufacture thick electrodes, basically oriented to transport application. So here we have lithium NMC811 cell with liquid electrolyte. And the idea is to investigate the maximum thickness in order to increase the energy density, even though we have different parameters in electrode design. So we will be concentrated on electrode thickness. As we know, there is this trend between energy density and electrode thickness, and this is for sure in the theoretical side. So we would expect something like this, improving the electrode thickness in order to have a higher energy density. But however, the reality is that we might have some limitation increasing the thickness. So this is what we usually obtain, and this is the red line shown here, what we usually obtain while increasing the thickness without modifying any other design parameters. So here, what we want to know is which is the optimum age or thickness or maximum age so that the mechanism's limitation are minimized or at least certainly avoid. So we did exactly in the same way we did with the solid electrolyte. We did the parameterization. We estimate the parameters, all the parameters regarding the electrolyte and solid phase as well. And then we compute the non-dimensional results. So again, we computed the 9 of them, and these non-dimensional results were computing dependent on thickness and even the serrate. So I'm showing here the most relevant one, and again is the concentration. Salt concentration, I mean, this grabbing concentration, and this is the result what we obtain while putting all the parameters in here. So, and then I set here the threshold of 1, meaning that when this parameter, the concentration parameters, is much lower than 1, we are not expecting any limitation. And when this value it's approaching to 1 or even slightly higher to 1, we start having certain limitation. And when we have a much higher or even higher value to 1, we would have a lithium depletion in the electrolyte phase. So taking this into account, we would say that this was the area in which we could have a lithium depletion. And then the one printed in blue in the area without any depletion. So now, as I said, we wanted to know which was the maximum age. And here we counted against serrate, but it can be done either by temperature or any variable or parameter that depends on the parameters. So here, as I said, we plot this value against the serrate, and we can definitely identify the maximum thickness against these rates. For instance, what this plot means is that and if we are running a test at 3C, we shouldn't exceed the cathode thickness up to 60 micron. While if we are running 2C, we could increase until 70 micron without any expected limitation to according to this. Then if we are running a test at 1C, we would definitely manufacture a cathode up to 100, and in that case we wouldn't expect any lithium depletion here. And for the this case 0.3C, we would even be able to manufacture 180 micron, meaning avoided any limitation due to lithium concentration depletion. So what we aim is, anyway, we as we said, We need to increase the thickness in order to increase the energy density. So it was not enough that, and we would like to improve the performance even and trying to increase in the thickness, but avoiding any limitation. So as we know, tortuosity, the electrolyte tortuosity is related to the ionic path. And we were having some limitation in the ionic path and ionic charge transport limitation. So in that case, and in our particular case with the NMC 811, we measured the tortuosity by symmetric cells. So and we discovered it was higher than one, it was around two. And what we were thinking that maybe if we try to reduce the tortuosity here, we would expect a better performance. So we did the calculation. So we recompute the non-dimensional parameters with low tortuosity. And in this case, we recomputed with tau e equal to one. And we got this graph for the salt concentration. So we, if you compare the line, these lines with the dashed lines, we certainly have a lower values in this, and meaning that we probably are reducing the limitation. So maybe if we concentrate it in 1C, this line refers to the previous case in which the tau e was equal to 2, and then we recomputed with tau e equal to 1. So as you are seeing here, until in the previous one, in previous case, until above 100, we would expect this limitation to the concentration, or at least this lithium depletion limitation. And now we could increase the thickness until 180 without having this limitation. So we increase substantially the thickness, and therefore the energy density, just modifying one parameter by this quick screening tool. So as a validation, we did the validation against the P2D simulations. So here what we are seeing is that the P2D simulation for the against half coin cell, we the conditions were 1C, 25 degrees and 180 microns with the tau equal to 2. And in this case, you can see here that the electrolyte concentration reached to zero, even at 10% of the electrode utilization. So the performance, and even if we are taking the integral of the voltage capacity, we would have a very low energy density here. However, and then if we are making the same simulation with the tau e equal to 1, we see that the electrode utilization increases until 95%. So, and we don't have any lithium depletion here. And as you can see in the voltage drop, and even though we have a certain limitation compared to the open circuit voltage, we substantially improved the performance. So it was to show how valid is this approach on identifying limiting mechanisms. So now I'm moving forward to the backward design. And yeah, and here the methodology is that we are having a target in performance, like for instance, they are defining certain lifetime, energy density, power density, or whatever. And we need to identify which are the optimum electrode properties. So here we can do it in this way. So coupling optimization algorithms and the electrochemical model. So and we did that. And so in this case, I'm just going to show some results. With instead of using the P2D model, we used a single particle model with electrolyte, which was it's referred here. And we implement optimization. So the optimization algorithms that was implemented was a quasi-Newton method, BFDS. And in this case, we wanted to know which were the best parameters of the one listed in here. minimizing or maximizing the energy, or here what it says here, minimizes the minus energy cost function. So here, according to the simulations, so the optimum value we got in that case, and it was a very particular case with very specific properties of the electrodes, we got 225, and the function was evaluated 800 times, and the computational cost was 605 seconds, which is not high, but the thing is that we usually run the P2D model because in the end, the single particle model is a simplification of the two P2D. So the computational cost at 1C of the single particle, it's less than 1 second in Python, sorry. We have our own codes in Python, and we usually use open source Phoenix as for discretized space by finite element method. So this is a computational cost for the single particle model, and then what the computational cost for the P2D is around 20 seconds, but only taking into account constant parameters. So if we multiply the 600 to the 20, more or less, it would give us the computational cost of the optimization problem. And it would be like around more than 4 hours to have one solution in optimization tool. So this is the reason why we were thinking to improve the computational cost or even the computational efficiency. And now we are suggesting reduced electrochemical models in here. So first I will give introduction to the neural networks and the work we have done in this area. And then I would also mention how we have implemented reduced order models and how we are improving the computational efficiency in this field. So for the neural networks, basically it's a series of algorithms in which you can correlate input and output, and the process is basically mimics the way that human brain works. And the methodology, I think there was already explained already in what they are doing in machine learning, and we did in a similar way. So we run simulations. We run randomly around 1,000 simulations in here with the P2D model. And then the 80% of them, we use them for training the algorithms, the neural network algorithms, and the rest of the 20% of the data, we use it for evaluating or testing the neural networks. And then the idea was to use KUP optimization tool to the neural networks to explore and to define the best properties of the electrode for a certain case. So this was the case we analyzed here, and the cell was graphite NMC 622. And what we did is that we ran simulations. I mean, here the output, this one listed here, and the output, the Ragone plot. And we ran simulations with this interval of the parameters that we were modifying. So we ran full simulation of the P2D running Python, and then we collect even the energy density and power density. These were all the parameters considered in this neural network and the output. So in this case, we basically we're thinking to implement two neural networks. The first one is the classification type neural networks. In this case, we want to see, as we know, not all the simulation were ended perfectly. So sometimes the simulation end dramatically due to certain limitation. So first we wanted to classify as zero in the case the simulation is not finished, and the classification is one when the simulation is ended at a certain cutoff voltage, so it worked perfectly well. So the classification neural network aim to classify between 0 and 1. And once this classification is made, and only for the simulations and for the data that it's in the framework of 1, we run the second neural networks. So, and the second neural network is for predicting the value of energy density and power density. So, as I said, yeah, the inputs are the ones I listed before, but I didn't mention, so it's like the electrode thickness, porosity, particle radius, separator thickness, and separator porosity, initial concentration of the electrolyte, ionic conductivity, and the applied C rate. And the output are the Ragone plot. So the two neural networks that were used in this scenario is the classification neural networks with two layers. And the first layer is with 10 neurons, the second is 18 neurons, and the prediction neural networks is again two layers. And the first layer has 24 neurons and the second 38 neurons. So in this case, these are the simulation, the 100 simulation we got from the P2D model we have at CDTEC. And in orange, you can see the success of the simulation that were perfectly well and finalized at the cutoff voltage. And then the in blue, the simulation that stopped dramatically. Okay. So for the classifications, we train it with 80 simulations, and then we test it with the rest of the 200 simulations. For the prediction neural, we train with 402 simulations because most of the, I mean, half of them were failed simulations, and the test were done with 100 simulations. So these are the results for the classification networks, and you can see here is the in blue true positive, in a meaning that the classification provides positive feedback, I mean, meaning that it has a value of 1, and the in the simulation was true, again 1. False positive is that the classification provides 1, and then the simulation was 0, while the true negative is that the classification provides negative, meaning 0, but the simulation was 1. And the last one is that the classification predicts 0 when it's 0. So this is the confusion matrix in a way that we can say the accuracy with the confusion matrix is around 90%. We are pretty sure that this number can be improved. But the message here is that we need around 600 seconds to perform the training, and the test it's really short, less than milliseconds. And then again, the results of the predictions here, the just for the simulations that were finalized, we built these neural networks, and again here the training data was around 1,000 seconds, while the evaluation or testing time is really short. So under RMSE, it's around 3.5. Again, we know that these numbers can be improved, and the thing is that here the value of the time for the testing value of the time is really, really short. But then we wanted to see what happens if we want to predict a point out of the data set. So if you remember, we use exactly, I mean, the values just to test this neural network are all the values, but the one listed in pointed in red in the interval we got the data set, instead for the concentration that we set this 1,000, which is out of the range we studied and we trained the neural networks. In this field, we are seeing that for the simulation output, we get these parameters. I mean, for energy density, it's something like 138, and the power density, it's around 34, while the neural networks predicts the really, really low value for the energy density, at least very far from the simulation results, and the power density, it's still a little bit far. So we lost the accuracy. So it's true that while if you are in the internal, you have trained the data and you have test data, it's really a very powerful tool, and we could then implement neural networks in principle in the range we have trained the data. However, if we are moving certainly to this frame, we might lose some accuracy. Okay, and then I will introduce our progress even to the reduce of the models. And the thing here is that, as I said, in advance, is that we want to improve the computational cost and the rationale. I mean, and in these systems, we have a high dimensional degree of freedom. We usually have high degree of freedom, a large degree of freedom, and what we want to do is to reduce this number of degree of freedom. And one option to do that is to use these reduce order models. So this is the baseline for the POD, which is the proper orthogonal decomposition. The idea is to remain in the accuracy of the model, is to make something computational efficiency via the dimensionality reduction. So we will provide a guideline how to reduce the dimension of the matrix so that we can definitely have something less that it has lower cost, but it maintains the accuracy. So here the methodology is that instead of having a high number of simulation, we would only need around 10 simulation for a specific case. And here we can combine different parameters, different testing conditions, so we can run when any simulation we would like, and we combine all the information, attract the variables within the time. So we implement singular value decomposition with a factorization method, and in this case we obtain a representative mode in a way that here we have something with lower degree of freedom, much lower than compared to here, and then we apply POD. And the thing is that the POD works perfectly well when we have linear equations, but here this is not the case, at least for the P2D or 1D or in this parameter dependence and scenario. So in that case, the POD is not as efficient as expected. So what we are proposing here is to implement trajectory piecewise linearization method in order to propose a combination of linearized equation to solve nonlinear systems. So then then finally we validate the ROM model, and then we implement optimization algorithms. So basically the motivation is the POD is basically database work. And the idea is, as I said, to find a low-dimensional approximation. So, for instance, we have a huge matrix with high degree of freedom, and then we implement this factorization that we, in the end, we have a multiplication of different matrices. But in here, we have the U, it's related to the modes, which are the characteristic numbers. And it's the mode that approximate the mother matrix. And then in sigma, we have the singular values, which is, and it's ordered somehow from largest to smaller. And it's related to the how important the modes are, or how relevant are the modes, and which are the number of modes that can be only considered in the next steps. And then the V, it's here, it's also are related to the time history of the modes. As an example, this is a simulation that we run in two conditions. This is related to, I mean, This would be the separator and then again the cathode. And in this case, we run simulation on 1C and 2C, and this is the ionic potential. So we have this matrix or with this order of magnitude, 1 degree of freedom's magnitude. So we run the SVD mode method, and then we computed the singular values. We represented the singular values, again, the number of modes, and we saw that the representative ones were only 5 modes, meaning that if we only plot this 5 degrees matrix, we were able to reproduce this matrix. So in the end, we substantially can reduce the dimension of the matrix, and then we implement the POD. So for the and then, as I said in advance, is that POD works perfectly well when linear system, but it's not applied. I mean, it's not efficient as expected in the non-linear system, and this is the why we are implementing this approximation, which is a combination of linear models through this TPWL method. And the method is already explained here perfectly. Okay, so as a proof of concept here, we wanted to address this this example. We wanted to identify the electrolyte diffusion coefficient. So we have this scheme or this setup. This is lithium, PO, LiFTCI with lithium foil, and then we implement pulse and relaxation, galvanostatic pulse and relaxation test. This would be the model. This is the why I said here 1D. So this is the model that you might already know, and this would be the test we run to the PO and the answer we got from the test. So here we implement the reduce of the models. We got the models. And then we run certain simulation with the parameters listed here. And we compare computational cost for the full model that I didn't say it, but we implement finite element method. And then we implement only the ROM only with the POD. And then the POD coupled to the TPWL. So the simulation time was around only 30 seconds. It was just a mega trial. And then we discovered that the computational cost for the FEM model was around is double of the simulation time. It was higher than 64. And then in the case of ROM, we computed 7 seconds. And for the case of POD and TPWL, we got only 0.1 seconds. So we got the simulation. So as you might see is that we had a substantial reduction on the computational load. So for solving the optimization problem, we group the this POD trajectory.
Yes, I think we are run on time. So it's 3:40. Maybe you can conclude. Sorry for that.
Okay. Maybe can you see the slides?
Yes.
Sorry, I just wanted to show that we had a good accuracy, and in that case, we first identified the value of the electrolyte diffusion coefficient depending on the concentration, and with that value, then we set another test. And you can see here that we got a really good accuracy, even though this test was not used for ROM implementation. So I would like to thank to all my colleagues here, and even to Fernando Varas from the Universidad Politécnica de Madrid, who is giving a support to us on the implementation of the reviews of the models and numerical approaches. So thank you. Sorry for the timing.
Thank you very much, Elizabeth, for your presentation. So very